All right, so welcome along, ladies and gentlemen, to your weekly SETI seminar series. Today we're very lucky to be joined by Pablo Sobron, who's a PI at the SETI Institute. Pablo did his bachelor's and a PhD at the University of Valladolid, and then a postdoc at Washington University here in the States, in St. Louis. He is now, as I mentioned, a PI at the SETI Institute. He's also a visiting scientist at the Canadian Space Agency, and he is the technological guru at Mineralogical LIBS, which is his startup company, which we're going to hear a little bit about. Pablo's career is focused on using spectroscopic technologies to better understand geochemical and mineralogical processes. He's very focused on instrument development and also data processing tools, and also technology transfer of space-related technology. He is also a co-eye on the Mars 2020 Sherlock instrument, which I think we're going to hear a little bit about, the Raman instrument. So please join me in welcoming Pablo.
Thanks, Adrian, and thanks for having me here today. It's a pleasure to be here in my home institution and talking about a little bit about what I do. And today I'm going to be talking about laser spectroscopy. Specifically, I'm going to be focusing on the field and missions that are upcoming or already working on Mars, like MSL, and trying to give a little overview of what we've been doing in the last decade or so in terms of maturing technology so that we can go to other planets and do science there. So I'm going to be giving a brief overview of three technologies that we're using today. First is Raman spectroscopy. Second one is LIBS, laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy, and MSL Curiosity rover has the first laser technique that has ever been flown to elsewhere. And I'm gonna spend a lot of time showing you part of the fieldwork and some of the experiments that we have put together to demonstrate that we can actually go to Mars or elsewhere and do actually cool stuff. And I'll finish the talk with kind of like a looking forward or what the next mission are going to be like and what do we expect from laser in the next decade or so. So to start with my favorite technology, I would say, and it's the first one that I had access to when I was in grad school back in Spain. So it's the Raman effect is conceptually is very simple. So light strikes a material and gets scattered, gets bounced out. And what happens is that it will change a little bit the energy. It will lose some of the energy that it inside in. And if you could quantify that change in the energy or wavelength of your incident light, you could fingerprint what molecules are being responsible for this light scattering. So giving some of the examples here, we'll show some more stuff later on. But basically, one of my favorite examples here is when you have calcium sulfate, either in the form of anhydride or gypsum or bastnaesite. The only difference between these three minerals is the water content. Okay, so just by removing some of the water from the minerals, you can observe a little shift in the sulfate bands in the spectra. So that shows the capabilities for fingerprinting that we could do with Raman. And of course, not only applies to gypsum or other calcite, but also for organics, as we'll see later, and carbon. And part of the interest about this technology is that you don't need to prepare your sample. Unlike other mineralogical technologies like XRD, while being more advanced in terms of being quantitative, you still need to powder your sample. You need to spend a lot of time and getting it to get the results that you want. With using laser Raman, instead, what you can do actually is real-time monitoring of your minerals. You don't need to prepare a sample, and you can do this in a very compact instruments that can be implemented in the arms, masts, can be handheld. There's been work on underwater vehicles, ROVs, that have Raman already there. Some people are working in drones, incorporating Raman. And we get the full kind of spectrum of molecules. Kind of every single molecule that you can imagine of is in principle amenable to be observed by Raman. So minerals, organics, and part of the success of the technology, or part of the lot of the money that we have used to advance it, it comes from early from the European Space Agency ExoMars mission. We selected the Raman instrument almost 10 years ago. And now with Mars 2020, if you have been following the selection, it has selected two Raman instruments to fly on the next rover to Mars. So certainly a pretty hot technique these days for space exploration. Another of the applications of laser that we can use for doing science in other planets is LIBS. So again, if you follow Mars and what we do on Mars, there is Curiosity has a LIBS instrument, and it's shooting, actually zapping rocks at a distance up to 7 meters every day. At least 200-300 spectra come from Mars every day just by shooting lasers on a rock. And what happens with LIBS, unlike with Raman, here you actually, you want to break down the molecules. You want to break your structure, you want to make a plasma, and you want to observe what the emission from the plasma is. And this is actually a real plasma made on a rock in the field with a portable instrument. And what you get from your plasma is a series of emissions, each one associated with different elements. So different elements, when they're in the plasma, they're excited. When they come back to the ground state, they emit light at a very specific wavelength. And we know what these wavelengths are, so we're just looking at comparison with a spectra with databases, and we can tell what elements we have there. Not only that, but by looking at intensities, we can actually quantify how much of the elements we have. This is a really powerful technique to be able to get chemistry out of minerals. And with a little bit of creativity, you could argue that you can do mineralogy as well. If you can constrain the relative abundances of elements, you could have at least an idea of what minerals you have in there. And that's what ChemCam is doing these days. And as I said, this tool is used every single day, over and over again. It's really cheap in a way to be able to detect chemistry at a distance. Instead of having to drive over there, deploy an arm, and do analysis, you can do it at a distance. And if you find that it's interesting, then you can actually drive there and do something else. But this is a very tactical tool, and that is actually becoming, or it's become, by some merits, key within MSL, and it's going to be flown again on Mars 2020. Last but not least, what usually happens when you shine a laser, the first thing that you notice when you shine lasers on things is that you have high backgrounds of light. Fluorescence, it's usually an enemy, and it's actually it's an opposite. Countering the Raman effect. It's competing effect with Raman. So some of the photons are emitted because of scattering of light. Some of the photons, and most of the photons actually, are emitted back as fluorescence. So the sample or the atoms will absorb the light, electrons will be promoted, and they will re-emit at different wavelengths. And that's this is your fluorescence, usually fluorescence background. And we've all seen that in museums when they shine a UV light in the middle, and it glows at different funny colors. And it's really simple to implement. It's really cheap as compared to Raman and LIBS. Also, you don't need to prepare samples, obviously, and you can put it together into a very compact system that can complement other measurements. As a matter of fact, fluorescence is going to fly also in 2020. Okay, one of the important things about fluorescence, one of the reasons why it's becoming very critical for Mars exploration, is because the organic detection becomes really accessible, and actually quantifying the amount of organics you have in the sample is becoming possible thanks to fluorescence. And what usually happens is that the fluorescence that comes from organic molecules, it happens at the wavelength that is really far away from minerals. So there is actually no ambiguity when you're looking at fluorescence spectra on whether you have organics or not. Okay, so it's really a complementary technique to mineralogy in the sense that it can give you organics detection, or a detection that is unambiguous. So these three techniques are the ones that I'm going to be showing examples of, and of how we apply them in the field, and what do we learn in the field, and how we can go to Mars, for example, and do some science based on this instrument. So to summarize, so Raman, it's very good at doing mineralogy, also organics. With certain limitations, but we'll see some of the examples in a few minutes. LIBS, because it breaks down the molecules, you only get information about the elements, okay? Again, there is statistical methods that we're using with ChemCam data to try and get mineralogy, at least upper and lower constraints based on chemistry. So it's possible within certain constraints. And fluorescence certainly can do organics, but also mineralogy if you're looking at the specific region or spectral region where the minerals happen. So as you can see, it will seem pretty straightforward to select these three techniques as a single payload system that you can fly somewhere where you can do all these things, right? As a matter of fact, March 2020, the SuperCam instrument that I'm going to be talking about later, it actually combines these three techniques into a single package. Same hardware to do all these measurements, so pretty powerful. I usually use this example to show people how do we get to fulfill all the NASA and ESA goals and other space agencies, of course, which these days are really focused on this part of the triangle here, risk reduction. If you tell NASA or ESA that you want to build something new and it's going to be the best and it's going to just change the world, they're going to tell you, show it to me first, and then we'll see how it plays out. So really, it's all about playing together in your lab, doing some fundamental research, go in the field, test back and forth, learn how to use your instruments in the field, come back to the lab, do more science, and finally go and send your instrument to another planet. And again, you can learn a lot by using instruments on Mars, like we did with ChemCam, for example, and we're actually working on new instruments based on what we learned from Mars, so that we always work together in these three kind of sections of this instrument development triangle. And more specifically, if you're familiar with the new reorganization of the research programs at NASA, NASA has come around finally to be able to make a clear path of instrument development that is really focused on starting with early technologies, very basic exploration. You get an idea. You may actually go to a conference, see somebody using the technique for something that you didn't think about. It's like, hey, you know, maybe you can work with that and use that in my projects and see how, you know, this can become something exciting for NASA. So you start thinking about your project. There is this Picasso program, which allowed you to start exploring early concepts for new technologies. And it's more money, but you can still do interesting stuff. And once you're to a point where you have proven the concept and you're ready to ask for serious money, NASA put together the Matisse program. And this is where you can actually, if you're an instrument people, you go to a scientist and say, hey, you know, I have this machine here. It looks cute and it's nice. Could you do something with it? Is there any science that we can do with this that can advance actually the way we explore planets? And or conversely, if you're a scientist and you're looking for answering a question, actually, you can reach to a technologist and say, hey, you know, I need to do this. Can you do it? So so this is where you actually put together your concept and start testing it in the lab, testing it in the field. Again, it's really, in my experience, it's been very important to go to the field with instruments, learn the lessons, come back to the lab, tweak it, go back, again, back and forth, and come up with something coherent. And now, once you reach a mature point, that you're ready to apply for this new program that is called PSTAR, and it's actually aimed to bring these instruments that are mature enough, that are looking promising for future missions, take it to the field and try to use them synergistically with our instruments in a concept of a mission, and try and learn how to do science with your packets. And it's interesting to me, and coming back to the fact of having small companies. There is, if you're familiar with the Small Business Innovation Research Program from across the government, every agency has a small SBIR program. They're trying to transfer technology that's one of the goals, is to bring people from government labs, from academia, into building products that are useful for industry. A lot of the things we do for NASA have great applications on Earth. SBIR is one of the goals, is to try to bring them back to Earth and do all the stuff with them, okay? And So now NASA has the same kind of, with the Picasso Matisse and P-STAR, has the same kind of roadmap that SBIR has, you know, with SBIR 1, 2, and 3. And just it's coming together, not just doing research for space, which is cool, but now we have a chance to actually make products out of the instruments we build. So it's becoming interesting. So I've been asked recently by actually a lot of people, how do you end up doing instruments and where do you start with? And in my case, I was interested in thermodynamics. I'm a physicist, and I was looking at energetics and kinetics of some minerals production, especially in Rio Tinto and Mars analogues and stuff like that. And I realized that when I took samples from the field, I came back to the lab, things have changed. I have lost my context, my geology, nothing made much sense anymore. And I say, well, we need to have something that we can take to the field, can do the science there in situ in real time, get data, and then I can do my models and make sure everything works fine. So that's how I started to work with Raman, laser techniques, and bring them to the field. So and this is kind of like the fundamental research approach to get to a mission instrument, is to learn phenomena in the lab, some science questions that you need to address, play with some data, scratch your head, build some small instrument, get something new, get the data you need. Answer your science question through inventing something new or using something that nobody has used before. And obviously, once you have your data from the lab, you want to go to the real world. And now there is commercial instruments that you can buy in basically any kind of technique you want. And Raman, LIBS, and fluorescence are not the exception. You can buy handheld devices for $10,000, $15,000 that anybody can take to the field and do science. What I think is interesting, what I really love doing, is to not just get in a system, do science there, but just integrate them with platforms. And most of you are probably familiar with these two projects in which the SETI Institute is heavily involved. And it's about integrating technologies to learn how to make a mission to Titan. How can we learn more about oceans in the solar system, but also how can we explore Mars and other rocky surfaces by implementing systems that give us a full idea of the chemistry, mineralogy, and organic content of our places. So this is where we integrate our systems with all moving platforms that we can get a hold of. And finally, of course, the whole goal for Holy Grail for us is to go to a mission and try and implement our systems into flight systems that can do science elsewhere. And here I'm showing a couple of examples here of this is the artist concept of the ChemCam instrument, shooting a laser from the mast into a rock, getting an image, getting a spectrum, learning the chemistry. And this is a concept for the ExoMars mission from the European Space Agency for 2018. This is the design of the Raman system that is going to be included in the rover, and also some examples of the Mars 2020 instruments that we're going to be launching pretty soon. So now let's go to the fun part and some of the work that we've done in the past, mostly thanks to NASA funding. Like in this case, AMACE is an A-STEP project, it's astrobiology and technology, new instruments to detect. To detect organics and minerals on other planets. So this is a prototype of a remote Raman system that we developed at the Center of Astrobiology in Spain. And we were looking at ice. We're looking at different ice structures, chemistries, and organic content in this system. So so what we did is just implement a telescope, laser, and shoot at different systems in the ice. In this case, we're looking at algae that happen in a glacier. And by looking at the peaks here, we get some information about the ice. In this case here, we're just showing two peaks that have to do with the O8 and water arrangement. And we can actually get some ice crystallinity based on the ice peaks. But more importantly, and I apologize for the contrast in this spectrum here, but we're looking at two different algae, green, red, different pigments to protect themselves from UV. And we realized that the fluorescence, these peaks here, broad peaks, are fluorescence emission from the samples. We induce fluorescence with our laser. So that was a surprise for us. We weren't looking for this. But we realized that the spectra were different. So we can actually tell things about the algae that were in the ice, on top of the information from the ice, but we could tell what kind of algae we had there by looking at the fluorescence spectra. So we were doing fluorescence plus Raman at the same time, which for us was a big surprise, and I think it's the first time that any remote system was doing that in the field. This is 2007. And more things we did with this system is to shoot at icebergs from a beach, trying to demonstrate how far could we analyze things at. And in this case, our record was 120 meters, and we were able to get clear spectra of ice. And not only that, but we had an imaging system in our prototype as well, and we'll be able to get micro images of different regions in the icebergs. And through processing of the images, we were able to tell different crystallinity. And from there, we hand over the data to glaciologists, and they were able to figure out different temperatures and pressures of formation during the iceberg creation. So that's really showing that we can put together a platform that we can take to the field and do science. Other things that we did is get a core 1 meter down in a glacier, and shoot it at distance and actually shoot it at different depths. So this is our core, and we're working at 20 meters or 10 meters, yeah, I think 15 meters maybe. And one of the things that we were able to get from there is that not only these two peaks that I was saying before inform about the crystallinity of the ice, different ice structures, but in some of the layers, some of the different depths, we could see fluorescence backgrounds, not only in this region here, but also in this region here. So again, we were exciting. We were inducing fluorescence in some organics within the ice core. So we were able to do, again, both simultaneous Raman analysis of the ice plus organic detection at a distance of 20 meters in the ice. Okay. So this is for remote analysis. Of course, the easy way to do it is with a close-up instrument. So we had a prototype to do contact measurements on the same systems. And of course, you get better resolution, better light throughput, and stuff like that. But again, the same phenomena happens. We observe if I can find my point, we observe different ice spectral envelopes here, again, informing about different crystal structures. But also, the fluorescence we excite in some of the samples is higher than others, meaning different organic content, or at least more or less organic content. So as a first line of defense or first line of detection of organics, Raman was proved to be sensitive to life, right? So going, but we're far away from any mission to an icy surface on the solar system. That's a fact. So of course we tested the system in more Mars analog accessible systems like Rio Tinto again, and these are spectra taken at about 5 meters on an outcrop that showed different sulfates and iron oxides and stuff like that. So it was very easy to do real-time detection of different minerals. And here I'm showing examples of gypsum, jarosite, copiapite, and other iron sulfates. These peaks here inform about the sulfate, and here is about the water structure. So we are really sensitive to water, and if water means habitability, Raman shown or proved to be a very sensitive tool to detect hydrated systems where life may thrive. And to prove the concept further, we went to a dry stream of water, a dry creek, where different evaporites happen. And we're trying to figure out whether the hydration state of the different minerals spatially distributed was different, or if we could inform about or we could correlate this with the shape or the topography of the system. And so we took spectra at each of the points here in this mesh and get different spectra. We're looking at the shift of the sulfate peak here. So shift informed about what is the big picture molecular structure there. If you have more water, your peak will be shifted to one side. If you have less water, it will shift to the other side. So by looking at this shift of the sulfate vibrations, we were able to come up with a 2D map of the hydration content of this system. So I would actually be able to reproduce the topography or the shape of this system just by looking at the Raman spectra of sulfate. Meaning that, let's say you're in a different planet, and you're looking at the exposure and you're looking at something that looks interesting, you could use Raman as a survey tool, and it's going to point you to what points are more interesting in terms of water content. So you could actually select a place to look further or more detailed investigations, or to even to drill or collect sample based on just information that you can get in real time with a laser system. Okay, and going back to the Arctic, we weren't happy with just shooting at lasers, again, at rocks with our handheld device, because that's pretty easy to do. So we also implemented our system. We adapted it to a rover platform. So we were able to perform remote science based on we were able to simulate a mission, kind of like a small size mission using a rover. So the exercise was to present the science team with a picture of a local location in the Arctic. And the science team, only based on the picture, had to select what points they wanted Raman spectra from and wanted more data from. So we're trying to prove whether we could detect life with Raman, basically. And this is an exercise that was conducted by Steve Squires in this expedition. And so he was actually being very focused on mimicking what MER are doing on Mars, or in that case, opportunity and spirit. Science team selected specific spots, and Raman was deployed by the robotic arm into these several locations. And we get all kinds of information about the rocks, quartz, dolomite, there is some pyroxenes, I don't think I put them here, but all kinds of igneous mineralogy that we could detect with Raman easy. But the most important fact for us and most fun results for us was the beta-carotene. We were able to find the organic pigments that living organisms use there as a sunblock. So we were able to detect life within rock matrix, just again by using a real-time laser sensing tool. That was one of the early demonstrations of integration of probably the first integration of Raman system with a rover. But last year, colleagues at Washington University and JPL, led by Carnegie Mellon and SETI Institute here, they were able to integrate a Raman system within a rover. Not just a rover arm like we did, but they did it within a rover platform. So the Raman system is installed here. The rover is able to drill down to 20 centimeters, collect powder, expose the powder to the Raman system, and the Raman system is able to get data of the subsurface. So this is the ultimate demonstration of how do you come from a lab system, commercial system, tweak it, make it better, improve things, bring it to the field, put it into a rover, and operate the rover from the US, this is in Atacama, and be able to do science remotely from the United States with a Raman system that is in a rover in Chile. So pretty spectacular results. The very first proper integration of a Raman system within a rover. Changing gears a little bit to LIBS, this is work that has been led by Honeybee Robotics in Pasadena. And this system is called LIBS-Log, and the goal here is to be able to do a chemical and mineralogical profile of boreholes. Okay? Applications of this, obviously, mining and natural resource, but also potentially going to Mars, drill, and be able to do a chemical profile of the drill at the depth. So here what we did is to deploy this system. Sorry about the quality of the video, but there should be some sparks happening. Yeah, probably you see them sometimes. And so we're moving the probe down in the borehole, 60 feet down, and shooting lasers and doing LIBS, making plasma. That's the bright light you see there. And that plasma again contains the elements and informs about the different chemical profile of the system. So using this system, we're able to, among other things, to get a chemical profile of iron. You could quantify how much iron do we have at the depth. But also, since we're making plasma, we're making little craters in our samples. We're ablating a little bit of samples. So we're drilling through also in the horizontal direction. So we were able to figure out that we needed about 50 shots to remove all the ice that we had there and get into the ore in this case. This one result that is actually pretty impressive and critical for mass exploration, where you always have weathering rings all over your rocks and your surface, and maybe you want to analyze what's behind the ring or below the ring. So you need to drill through somehow. So the RAT tool on MER does that, and ChemCam on MSL does that as well. So it's every single pulse you're ablating picograms, but you know, over time you're making a drill or a hole that is deep enough that you're accessing what's behind your alteration ring. So that's about solids, rocks and stuff. Of course, we're not limited to do solid materials. We can do liquid analysis as well. And I believe this is also the first demonstration of a so-called portable Raman system. It's the one you can see here in the trunk, as used in the field to do in-situ sensing of liquids. And this is my very first field trip. And this is the system we came up with to be able to analyze the water in Rio Tinto. So Rio Tinto, as I was saying before, is full of sulfates, a lot of water-rich systems, and so happens that all these waters that are very acidic, they also have bacteria living there. They have algae, and they have communities that were thought that wouldn't be possible to have there. So we're trying to look at the chemical properties of the systems here. And in this case, we had the probe, and we immersed it in the water at different distances, down to 20 centimeters, I believe. And what we're looking at here is the sulfate vibration band within the water and the water band. So different depths, the ratios of the peaks are different, meaning that we have our distribution of pH or sulfate content changes as a function of depth. But it was a pretty new result for us. But most interesting than anything was that as we were approaching the bottom, we were seeing this fluorescence background here, which was telling us that there was something happening there, some bacteria or something. And it turns out that it was algae that were thriving in the bottom. You couldn't see it from the surface, but it's too red the water to see anything through, but there is algae down there. So that was pretty striking result for us. And again, proving that we can do, in this case, water chemistry, but also find organic content in the water. Not too long after this, colleagues at Mbari were able to put together a Raman system and take it down to the bottom of the ocean. I believe this system in this paper here was deployed at 3,000 meters below the ocean. So they enclosed a full Raman system and put a window on one side and shoot laser through the window and analyze a chimney, a hydrothermal vent in the bottom of the ocean. So things they found out is that, for example, there is a thermal profile. Of course, there's thermal profile in the vent systems, but you could see it with the Raman system because the water bands change with temperature. So they were able to prepare a calibration curve, and they were able to figure out the temperature of the water based on the Raman profile of the water related bands here. So that was one of the things that they found out. Of course, sulfate and some other water vibration as well. They have a diamond line here, and that's the diamond they use for calibration, which is embedded in the glass to make sure that they always keep the reference for the spectra. And they also analyzed, among other things, they analyzed some biomass around the vent, and they find out beta-carotene. And this kind of slope that goes high here, that's fluorescence. So again, they were inducing fluorescence that they were using to figure out whether there was more or less organics within their system. So that's a pretty extreme example of application of laser. And recently, last year, actually, this is the very first LIBS system that has been deployed underwater. And this is from colleagues from the University of Tokyo in collaboration with JAMSTEC and a couple of other agencies in Japan. And so I believe there is a paper that is coming up pretty soon. So if you are interested, stay tuned. But these are, so I'm showing here the results of the lab tests they did with this system. And of course, there is limitations to using LIBS in the water, especially at pressure. Remember, LIBS, we're ablating systems. We are making plasma. Plasma expands, emits light, and that's where we're reading. If you have a lot of pressure around you, the plasma is not going to expand, and you're not going to be able to read the light out of that. So the solution for that is to make a double pulse system. So the first pulse, you make a little bubble. Second pulse, you shoot inside the bubble. So your plasma will expand freely within the bubble, and you have enough light to get actually a pretty nice spectrum. So this is one of the lessons learned from the field. When you go there and test it and you think everything's going to be fine, it's not. So you have to come up with new ideas. But anyway, in summary, they got pretty good results with the system, and they had the funding to go there this summer, actually, to go back again and do actually real science. So that's another impressive result that I think was worth mentioning. And just to finish with some of the space applications of all these technologies, the first one is ChemCam on MSL. It's been 2 years already, and there is about 250,000 spectra that haven't returned from ChemCam. Okay, every single day, and every single day there is anywhere from 400 to 2,000 spectra that are returned to Earth for analysis. Okay, and what ChemCam is doing is, again, at 7 meters, up to 7 meters, is shooting lasers, sapping rocks, and getting their spectra, the chemical information. And this is the very first LIBS spectra ever taken on Mars. And one of the things that that is interesting here is, and that we see over and over again in every single spectrum, is that the first shot on a clean surface contains a lot of hydrogen, okay? But it quickly disappears. So first shot, hydrogen line, second shot, less, 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 and less. And that's been constant throughout the mission. The obvious inference from that is that there is always a fine layer of dust that is hydrogen rich. And by looking at the silicon lines, which which always change too, I think the most feasible theory that says like there is small hydrated silicon, hydrated silica or hydrated silicate that that is covering Gale crater. But that's one of the things that you could only verify if you had a tool that can let you do quick, fast analysis in several locations. Again, this is the first application of laser to space exploration. Lanel made a terrific job at putting together this system, and it's become already a really key and critical tool for ChemCam, for MSL actually. Funny enough, ESA was the first agency to recognize the value of LIBS and Raman actually. So they selected the Raman LIBS system back in 2004 to be flown in 2009. And so the PI of this instrument is my thesis advisor. And so I was working on the design of the system, and unfortunately ESA de-scoped the LIBS part. So we only stuck with the Raman system, and this is the design of the system as it is right now, very simple. And ExoMars, one of the interesting things for ExoMars is that it's gonna be able to drill 2 meters if everything works okay, and collect the powder, collect the core, crush it, and expose that powder to our Raman instrument. So that's where the test that I showed you in Atacama becomes relevant, because this is an example of the analogy between what you do in the field to what the mission is going to look like. So by learning how to do that in Atacama, we're informing ESA and ExoMars on how to operate the Raman system. So it's the same concept. And hopefully ExoMars will be flying in 2018. So we'll be able to get Raman data from Mars in 2020, hopefully. And Raman here is expected to do mineralogy, but also organic detection. So it's been designed to be responsive to both the fluorescence and the Raman peaks of organics, plus the minerals, of course. And to end up with the two Raman instruments selected for 2020, the first one is Sherlock from JPL. So Sherlock is gonna be looking at the fluorescence of the organics plus the Raman bands of the organics. So it's gonna be looking at the two competing processes that happens when you shine laser into your sample, and by using a UV laser, they're going to be able to separate both in the same exposure. So with the same camera, the same system, and a small mirror, they're going to be able to map the surface of a 1 by 1 square centimeter and get get a very clear and definitive organic detection. Should organics be on the surface there? And one of the things that Sherlock can do too is there's going to be a drill, we think, still to be determined, on the arm. And Sherlock is going to be able to look at the walls within the drill, within the borehole. So again, that's one of the lessons that we have learned from using our systems in boreholes, is how to look with the geometry we're looking for, angles and things like that, to be able to get to maximize the output from our borehole when we shine lasers into them. So this is Sherlock, and SuperCam is the big brother of ChemCam. And so not only is it going to build on the LIBS capabilities of ChemCam, but it's going to include a Raman system, a fluorescence system, and an IR system, plus the imaging. So basically, it's like a five instruments in one, and it's going to be able to do that almost in real time, in sequence, on the same spot. So going back to the table that I showed earlier before, same spot, same measurement, we're going to be able to get chemistry, mineralogy, and organics, plus imaging if we want to do some texture analysis as well. So that's one of the most exciting instruments that I've ever seen. Not that I'm part of it too, but it's really powerful in a sense that it can provide so much information, especially thinking that you can do it at a distance of up to 8 meters. That is, I think, it's a very valuable tool that is gonna make a difference for 2020, like ChemCam is doing for MSL. But and just to finish with the last slide of what the transfer means when you're talking about NASA investments or ESA investments in space, mining, especially mining companies, are becoming aware of all the developments we're doing, and they're trying to piggyback on these technologies to actually make a difference in their business. So, for example, rovers with lasers has been proposed and has been developed by Rio Tinto for mining. And UAVs, as soon as the FAA figures out the the policy for aerospace here, they're going to become a tool in every single field application, commercially speaking. Seafloor development, big thing these days. All the ores that happens around the vent systems. There's companies like Nautilus from Canada is looking into technologies to identify where to mine, quick and fast and cheap. And obviously planetary mining as well, if it ever happens, but there's money being invested in this already. And again, the key is to quickly and cheaply find the place where you need to drill, where you need to get your resources. So using technologies like the ones I've been talking about here, you can get a good sense of what you're looking at. And obviously, medical imaging, all kinds of applications for biosciences. And I believe I was talking with Esbjorn earlier that there was a talk earlier this year about this D-STAR, planetary defense system. Somebody's concept is to shoot lasers at asteroids as they approach so you can blow them up. And I was hoping that before we can blow them up, we can get some spectra back from there, just to have an idea on what they're made of. But, so I'll leave it here and I'll take any question that you have. Thank you for your attention.
Pablo, if I could start. The SuperCam instrument, what's the IR range that they're going to be sensitive to?
So the IR range, they have a visible range anywhere up to 900 nanometers, but then they jump and they start into 1.3 microns again, up to 2.8 microns. So it's an extended near mid IR system that can inform a little bit about the IR spectroscopy as well.
What improvements in lasers would you like to see to help you make better instruments of this type?
Compactness is the key. Being able to have smaller lasers, which means probably being able to make better cooling systems so they can be miniaturized and at the cheap price. Lasers that you need to do this kind of thing, especially LIBS, are bulky because they need water cooling usually. So you need the pump that cools or pumps water to sink some of the heat that produces the LEDs that produce the laser. So the advance will come into using diode state pump lasers that are smaller, compact, and more stable. So I would say it's a matter of cooling. We have figured out the way to make the cooling systems more efficient, and of course miniaturizing the whole thing. It's a size volume constraint. basically.
Hi. So I was interested in your distance tests at 120 meters and all that with Raman. I'm wondering if in the post Mars 2020 timeframe, this tool could be used on gliders or blimps or little drones like that, on Mars or Titan or someplace like that.
So one of the problems with using standoff distances, standoff systems that use lasers to analyze samples, is that the atmosphere is going to disperse a lot of your laser, right? So for Mars, turns out that 8-10 meters is about a reasonable distance for us to analyze. It's a matter of size. Bigger is better here. So bigger laser, bigger telescope lets you go farther. Now, the trade-off is that distance. But on the moon or Europa, for example, where there is no atmosphere, it's pretty much vacuum, there is theory studies that claim that within 8-inch telescope and a normal laser, you could do 20 kilometers Raman analysis. LIBS is trickier because you need to focus tight to make sure you make the plasma. But for Raman, at least 20 kilometers seems to be feasible, at least on paper. Now we need to have a 20 kilometers chamber where we could test that. But it's a matter of absorption of the light in your atmosphere. And actually, if you're familiar with SAGE, the mission that was proposed for Venus, one of the three finalists with Inside, Moonrise, and SAGE was for Venus. There was a Raman LIBS system proposed for that. And the farthest they could do, it was half a meter, because thick atmosphere, it just sucks up all your laser and you don't see anything. So, yeah.
I've got a question. I was somewhat confused over the observation of, I think you said hydrogen.
Yeah.
There was this, something appeared and then vanished.
Yeah.
Could you, what just was it that,
So we think that, So LIBS is very sensitive to hydrogen content. Okay, so whenever you have something that is hydrated, you get the hydrogen blind where I showed you.
Well, now, so is it OH? It's not H2.
It's not hydrogen. Just hydrogen atoms within your system. In this case, within the layer that covers rocks on Gale. So it looks like there is always a very fine layer, at least it's a one-shot layer for us, that contains hydrogen. As soon as you remove that layer after the first shot, hydrogen is gone.
But are these vibrational?
No, that's the recombination of atoms and electrons in the plasma.
This is
plasma.
Oh, it's a plasma. Oh, yeah, I see. Okay, now yeah. I misunderstood.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But has anybody actually repeated that in the lab here?
The problem with the lab is that unless you have a Mars chamber, you always get a little bit of water from the atmosphere. So it's really difficult to get only the mineral that you're shooting at. You always get atmospheres. You get CO2, nitrogen, and oxygen. Now, we've done tests on chambers and with all kinds of minerals. And of course, you know, we have different sandwich prepared materials that we can actually know exactly where we are and get different chemical profiles based on the layers. But that's not to happen. So it's not.
But did you see any decrease in oxygen as well?
Oxygen is tricky because CO2 on Mars gets broken down too. So you get oxygen lines from, as well as carbon lines from your atmosphere on Mars, which we don't have a way yet to decouple from the oxygen within the samples. That being said, having a Raman on 2020 is gonna help figure this out, because it's gonna be able to see, hey, this is a hydrated silica, rich material. This is what it is, this layer. When you remove it, that's it, and now you have oxides or other stuff underneath.
Yeah, when analyzing organic material, how close are you to being able to tell the difference between just a collection of organic material and something that's alive?
Okay, so that's the that's the name of the game. So what we can do very easily with Raman is to distinguish between organic carbon and inorganic carbon. Okay, like coming from bio-related systems or not. So that we can do with Raman. Now fluorescence, that's gonna be the answer to their problems, because with this system, the Sherlock system, using a UV laser, that's when you are going to be able truly to determine whether you have organic products there. At least you have the relics of the product. Getting moving live living things with lasers, I don't know, tricky. That's not uh, that's not the It's not. I don't think it's an answer we can give as of now using this kind of techniques.
Well, if it moves when you shoot it, it's probably a lie.
If it moves when you shoot it, it runs away. Yeah, you probably have it. But I think there is that will require sampling, and that's why the sample return missions are being thought of.
This is pretty basic. What are Raman units and per centimeter of what?
Oh, so that's frequency.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's the inverse of wavelength. It's just a convention to.
One last question.
One last question. Okay. Going back to Mars and the results that you were talking about, getting hydrogen off doesn't surprise me. The question is, what is the hydrogen? Is it frost? Is it coming from the water, or is it solar wind implanted stuff, something like that? But what really intrigues me is your comment about silicon. You said silicon was doing something similar.
Yeah, so we can see a variation in the silica, in the silicon peaks as well.
Just
so it looks
pure
like
aside.
they decrease also a little bit when the hydrogen line goes away. So that's the thought, is that could be a layer for a silicate, small dust layer on top of the
something
rocks.
Very, very fragile.
Yeah, but it's like it looks like a wind deposited thing that is just covering very finely.
So you're just burning off the dust.
Yeah, but it goes away quickly. And the thing with LIBS is all the elements are very sensitive to LIBS. So you see almost all the elements all of the time.
But things like clay minerals or highly unstable minerals. It's not going to be pure silicon. That's what.
Oh no! Of course not. Of course not.
So you're seeing other things come off equally.
Again, so with LIBS, you're getting almost all the elements all the time. So the key here, and I was mentioning that before, like you can be creative and imply mineralogy based on LIBS spectra, but that's very. I would take it carefully. So we don't have a tool, as of now, on MSL that can give us mineralogy in the same spot as ChemCam is doing, as the LIBS is doing. So we're just inferring what that layer may be made of just based on one shot, which is noisy and which it's semi-quantitative. So it's a guess. It's a best guess. That's where it is. It could be a combination of oxide plus silicate or sulfate. We don't know. Raman will be able to figure that out in 2020.
All right. Well, if you have any more questions, come up and chat to Pablo after this. Pablo, we have a special mug there. I'm sure that this would make an excellent blank target for calibration purposes in your laboratory.
Thank you.
Or you can drink something from it as well. So please join me in thanking Pablo for his great talk.
Thank you.